Yo, what is up, guys? We are back, and today I want to talk about Smash Bros. Ultimate, specifically how we're going to be controlling Smash Bros. Ultimate. Now, some of you out there might use the Joy-Cons and the Joy-Con grip. I don't have my Joy-Cons, they're on my Switch, but you get what I'm saying. You might use that. Some of you might use a Pro Controller, and that's a very valid option. But for some of the more hardcore Smash fans, you're going to be looking at a GameCube controller. Now, with Smash right around the corner, there have been a lot of third-party and official first-party GameCube controllers that have flooded the market recently. And although I don't have the kind of budget to buy one of every single one that's on the market, I do, however, have purchased one that I particularly interested me the most out of all of them. And two, I have the original GameCube controller right here. Now, when I say original, I don't mean the GameCube controller that is being re-released by Nintendo for the Switch that's still wired. It's basically the exact same thing with this, but with a Switch or Smash logo on it. And I don't mean any of the ones that were released for Wii U. This is an original GameCube controller that came with an original GameCube such as this. It actually did not come with this one. It came with my neighbor's GameCube. Mine came with a silver controller, and we swapped controllers when we were kids. But yes, this is an original GameCube controller. And this is the Power A wireless GameCube controller for Switch. Now, there are quite a few differences between the two. I'm going to go over as much as I can with as much detail as I can. First of all, I should start by saying the price for this thing is $50 US. And right off the bat, if we compare the two, you can see a few differences. Now, I'm going to go over that the best I can right now. So, when we take a look at the OG original GameCube controller, we notice a few things. There is no ZL button. The sticks do not click down. You cannot click these down. As hard as you push, they will not click because there's no buttons under there. And you also notice that there is a single start button, no home buttons, nothing, just a single start button. And the D-pad is actually quite tiny. For what the GameCube controller was, for such a great controller that it was, the D-pad was fucking terrible on the original. So that is the original GameCube controller. Just a few things I wanted to point out. Now, when we compare to this, you will see larger D-pad. Let's see here. Larger D-pad. I'm looking in the capture here, but larger D-pad, which is a huge improvement. I've actually tested this while playing the original Legend of Zelda on the Switch, and I can say it is a vast improvement over this D-pad here. And it's much larger and a lot more accurate, leading you to have less mistakes. But in Smash specifically, the D-pad isn't going to be used all that much. But it is nice. It's a nice improvement. Now, I do want to talk about the finish, or the plastic that is used here for both of these controllers. Now, the sturdiness of the plastics, I'm squeezing right here on this hollow point of the controller on both ends, and they both feel about the same as far as how sturdy they are. However, the finish that has been chosen for both of these controllers is very different and noticeable almost immediately after touching it. You might not notice it from pictures, but when you actually hold it in your hands, it's very noticeable. The original GameCube controller has is almost like a semi-gloss to it, or yeah, I would say probably about a semi-gloss or something like that. That is very nice, feels very nice to hold, and overall, you might get a few fingerprints on there, but it feels nice. This finish, however, feels a little bit cheaper, I want to say. But it still feels good. It still feels good in the hand. You're actually going to get less fingerprints on this finish than you would the original, which I think that is a nice trade-off there. So yeah, that being said, some people might get really freaky about that. Other people, they might not care. So I did want to point that out. But like I said, we do have a larger D-pad. The sticks do click down now, if you can listen here. So they do click down now. They're actually quite loud as well, which some people might be annoyed by that. I actually prefer louder button clicks, just as a personal thing. I don't know why. It just is a lot more satisfying to me. So they do actually click down now. And actually, when we compare this thing to a Pro Controller or any modern controller, it has all of the inputs you're gonna want to need. You have your A, B, X, Y. You have your shoulder, or I guess triggers, but on a GameCube controller, I wouldn't necessarily call them triggers. They're just bigger shoulder buttons. But we do have those, and they are quite loud. They're actually a bit louder than the original GameCube. Of course, this is a really old GameCube controller and not like a brand new one, so that might just be because this one's old. But I do want to say that you have all of the inputs you would have on a modern controller. Plus, you also have the capture button and the home button and the plus and minus button, which is what you would have on a Pro Controller. So since I mentioned the triggers before, I do want to point out the triggers, or I guess the large shoulder buttons, because again, on a GameCube controller, I don't really think they would classify as triggers. But for the sake of keeping things simple, I'm just going to call them triggers for the rest of the video. The triggers on this controller, the new one, they're not exactly the same as the original. And what I mean by that is both in function and in shape, as well as finish. They have a gloss finish on them, whereas the original had more of a matte finish, which is not that annoying. It doesn't bother me at all. But what bothers me is that the shape of the triggers is actually slightly different. I'm sure I'll get used to that over time, but just picking it up, that was an immediate, like, kind of shock to me to feel that, hey, something doesn't feel right here. Again, I'm sure I'll get used to that over time. But as far as that goes, they do otherwise feel the same. However, functionally, they are not the same because on the original, they were analog. This is actually a digital input because the Switch does not register analog movement from the triggers. It's not programmed that way. These are not analog. These are digital. They're just imitating the analog that the original would have had, which is not a big deal, but it is important to note that. That being said, moving on to what is now the R and L button, which originally would have been the Z button, and this button didn't exist on the original, but now it's the R and L button. These are a lot beefier than the original. If we can get a comparison here, you can see this button is very small, barely sticks out, And you can see these, on the other hand, are massive. Now, some people might be annoyed by that. I think that is a huge improvement over the original. And again, these are much louder. Now, again, that could just be because this controller is very old, whereas this one is brand new. But I don't remember the Z button being that loud on the original, so I'm just gonna assume that's how it's always been for the sake of the video. So, when we compare most of the buttons on here, we can see most of them are much louder. The A button, on the original, most of them are, pretty much all of them are louder, which again might not be a big of a deal to people, and some of you are probably wondering why are you going over this, but some people really take this stuff seriously, so I want to go into as much detail as I possibly can. So we've compared the buttons, the both loudness and feel, we've compared the D-pad, we've compared the click on the sticks to whereas the original didn't have that. Now what I want to talk about is travel. Now, for those of y'all who aren't aware, travel is a term that is used to describe the distance that you have to push a button before it registers an input. Now, the A button travel feels about the same, whereas the X and Y buttons feel like they're actually slightly longer travel on the new one, and the B button feels about the same. Now, as far as the shoulders actually feel like they have less travel than the original, which is a good thing. Less travel is always better. And the shoulder buttons feel like they have significantly more travel on the new one. Now, as far as the sticks, which, again, the sticks also have travel when you move this way. How far can I move before I hit the maximum? How much time does it take before I hit the maximum amount of distance this way I can go? And I'm happy to say that the travel for the sticks on this new controller is actually slightly less than the original. I've tested it a couple times, and as far as I can tell, it's slightly less, which is a good thing. That is a very good thing. So, we've compared the buttons, we've compared the travel, we've compared the finish, all of that stuff. What else is there to talk about? Well, this little guy, in addition to having extra inputs over the original to kind of bring it into the modern age, it's got a few other neat features. Now, first of which being that it's wireless, but unlike the WaveBird and most other wireless options out there, this is wireless directly to the Switch, so you don't need any adapters, no dongles. It just uses Bluetooth straight to the Switch, easy as it can possibly be. And this next bit I'm gonna go into may sound a bit strange, because it sounds like it's something that should be obvious for every controller out there, but believe it or not, it's not for most third-party controllers from what I've seen. And that is, once you pair this to your Switch, if you turn the Switch off and turn it back on, it will still be paired to the Switch. Now, that sounds like a very obvious thing. Well, obviously all controllers would do that. Except that's where you're wrong. There's actually quite a few third-party controllers that are wireless for the Switch. Not necessarily GameCube ones, but just controllers in general. that you have to pair them every time you turn on your Switch, and that is something that is very annoying. This, on the other hand, you don't have to do that, so I did want to mention that, because there are some controllers out there where you do have to do that. That being said, however, there are a few other features to this other than the wireless connectivity, and that is probably one of the strangest features this thing has, is that it has motion controls. That is right, this has motion controls built into it. It has motion controls. If you're playing Super Mario Odyssey and you go like this, you're going to be throwing your hat around. If you're playing Splatoon, you can use the motion controls. Any game that has motion controls, this thing has got your back. Now, that being said, this controller overall sounds like a really good deal. It's got a good price. It's, for the most part, has a lot improvements over the original. But there's got to be something bad about it, right? Here's where we get into things. For the price that they have this at, which is $50, there had to be some corners cut. Here is what they've done. There is no rechargeable battery, which for some people immediately is going to be enough to say, I don't want this. But for me, not that big of a deal. So there are batteries in the back that you will have to replace, or you could just buy rechargeable AA batteries and just keep a pair of those and a charger. But you will have to swap those out every now and then, which is not the biggest deal in the world. I would have liked to have seen an option that had a rechargeable battery, but, you know, for the price it's at, I can kind of understand that. But here's where things get a little disappointing, and that is the lack of rumble. There is no rumble whatsoever. And again, I understand why they did that. I would have liked to have seen rumble over motion controls, to be honest, but that's just me. But it is important to note that. Other than that, this thing's golden. I've tried out both, not on Smash, obviously, because Smash isn't out yet as of recording this video. But I will say, at the price point it's at, it's a good buy, and from what I've seen from other offerings they have, third-party-wise, it seems like the best option available as of right now. So, yeah, that's about it. So, yeah, I said I was going to do this video. It's a little bit later than I would have liked to have, but hopefully a few of you found this helpful. There will be links to this product down below in the description. And, yeah, I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye, guys.